So my presentation today is regarding the pathogenic inheritance. I think you have heard about the cytogenetics and the molecular genetics aspects of the genetics learning from the previous two presentations. So why we need to know the pathogenic inheritance? So that when they come to the clinical settings, most of the patients that comes to you, and therefore you just need to have some kind of a differential diagnosis that comes to mind to go for the next investigation process and which helps in the counseling. Therefore, once the patient comes to you, then you have to identify which kind of this disease, that genetic disorder that this patient is having for the next round of investigation process. Therefore, at the end of this presentation, you should be able to define the genetic terminology and some pattern of inheritance, and outline the patterns of Mendelian inheritance, outline the pattern of non-Mendelian inheritance, and analyze related genetic charge. Because these are the important aspects that comes when you first contact with the patient. So I will use few seconds to give some insight to the history of genetics. So that genetics has its roots back in 19th century in the work of the Bohemian monk Peter. You all know about that. That you all have learned about these things in your A-level. So he has postulated the theory that the concept of learning inheritance. And later in 19 after the World War II, the medical genetics was developed. And the Victor Mackusi, who died in 2008, was at the father of medical genetics. What is pattern of inheritance? So the pattern of inheritance is the manner in which the gene is transmitted from one generation to another. So this is very important to understand and to identify the important characteristics of that particular genetic disorder to confirmation about the final decision. So this was initially described by Gregor Mendel, and by its important two laws, the Mendel's first law or the law of segregation, and the Mendel's second law or the law of independent assortment. What is law of segregation and law of independent assortment? So what is segregation? You all know during the meiosis one, each gene has their own two alleles will segregate and go to the walls of the cell to form the new gametes. And this segregation is important when it comes to the formation of gametes in sexual reproduction. What is assortment? So you know that when we considering a single gene, so this has the two alleles, right? Segregates the two poles of the cell, and once responsible for some other important conditions, yeah, that particular allele of that individual gene will carry or will accompany the other allele of another gene, and that accompaniment is random when considering whether that particular allele is paternally derived or the maternally derived. So that's randomly. They choose their allele and segregate to the poles of the cell, the dividing cell in the meiosis, and that is random. So this ultimately gives you some insight into the some pattern of inheritance in some genetic disorders. And this shows that the connects there, where that in the left side. So the monohybrid cross where I involve the one gene with two alleles, and in the other side, the right side, involves the two genes with four alleles that segregates in different manner, and ultimately it shows that there will be different consequences in different ratios due to this assortment. We'll talk about it. I think you all know these things. And therefore, I'm not going to discuss it. Before we go into the next slide, I just want to show some important aspects regarding regarding some important genetic terminology. The first that is regarded to some generations, chromosomes and genes, as well as about the dominant or the recessive pattern, genotype and the phenotype. So regarding the generations, we consider it as the P, that is the parental generation, and it is F1, the children of generation P, and F2 is the children of generation 1. Then we have the chromosomes. You all know about what is chromosome, what is gene, what is locus, and what is an allele. So that the chromosome is the macromolecule bounding cells consisting of DNA, protein, and RNA. The gene is the unit of heredity of a living organism or living person, individual. Locus is the specific location of the gene, DNA sequence, or position in a chromosome. An allele is one of a member of alternate form of the same gene or genetic locus. And dominant and recessive means the dominant allele is the allele that is always expressed, if present, and the recessive allele is the allele that is only expressed if the dominant allele is not present. I think I am not going to discuss this detail because you all know these things. And when it comes to the other areas, that is genotype and phenotype. So what is genotype? Genotype is the genetic makeup of a cell, of an organism, or an individual. And phenotype is the observable characteristic or the traits that one you can see, what is the picture that you will see. And when it comes to homozygous and heterozygous, homozygous means the content of two of the same allele of a gene, and heterozygous means contain of two different alleles of a gene. Before I go into the next slide, I will just describe some basic pedigree structure, drawings, and terminology. They are in the right side of the slide. You can see some diagrams. So this basic pedigree structure include some individuals, that is represented by symbols, and their relationships. So therefore, the pedigree is the graphical representation of relations of that particular family members into the program. So therefore, this individual will be represented by different symbols. So that a circle is indicated to be female, and square is indicated the male, and once it is colored, then it is mentioned as the affected individual. And once it gets crossed by a line, that is called diseased individual. And we know that there are some carrier states in our society. It can be either autosomal carrier state or the sex linked carrier state. So if the circle or the square is colored half, so it indicates an autosomal carrier state, and if a circle with a dot, it indicates X-linked carrier state. And on the left side, you can see a circle and the square, that is a male and female, connected by a single line, which indicates male. And once that connected with the two lines, it indicates male between relatives or consanguinity. And when we draw the pedigree, so you can see that the relationships can be demonstrated by lines, so that you can see the mating and the biological children of that particular generation. And these generations can be nominated as Roman numerals in 1, 2, 3, likewise. And when we indicate the siblings, the firstborn is in the first instance, and the last one in the last instance. And also you can make it numbers in 1, 2, 3, 4. For the identification. So other important part of that relationship is identical twins, and that is monozygotic twins and the dizygotic twins. So you can see the The twins can be indicated as a line that comes from that particular biological parent, and it can be connected with one line as the monozygote and without connection with the dizygote phase. Then we'll be moving into the main categories of genetic disorders. Why we need to learn the categories of genetic disorders in case of pattern of inheritance. The genetic disorders falls into five main categories. Therefore, these different categories have different pattern of inheritance where it gives some kind of insight to diagnose or come to a differential diagnosis on that particular patient at the clinical setting where can go ahead and request a specific genetic investigation for that. So it is better to have some kind of an insight regarding the main categories of genetic disorders. So we can divide these genetic disorders into single gene disorders, chromosomal disorders, multifactorial disorders, somatic cell genetic disorders, and the mitochondrial genetic disorders. So we'll move into the next slide. So I'm going to discuss the single gene disorders, which also called Mendelian or monofactorial disorders, because this was initially described by the Mendel regarding the initial allele segregation law. So these traits produced by one or pair of the gene, which has a lower incidence, such as 3.6 per thousand live births in the Western countries. And these single gene disorders again can be divided into four main categories: the autosomal dominant, autosomal recessive, X-linked, and the Y-linked. And again, X-linked disorders again can be divided into autosomal X-linked dominant and the X-linked recessive disorders. We'll move into the next slide and discuss in detail about these different types of Doppler disorders. The autosomal dominant disorders. Different kind of disorders has different kind of inheritance patterns, the transmission patterns. Therefore, it is important to identify different transmission patterns or the inheritance patterns of these disorders. Where you can then finalize the differential diagnostic list that you are having, or maybe come into the clinical diagnostic before going to the special genetic investigation or other investigation or for the genetic counseling. Therefore, there are some important criteria for the diagnosis of autosomal dominant disorders related to the pattern of inheritance. So these autosomal dominant disorders transmitted from one generation to the another generation and from there to another generation. So there's no of generation. Each and every generation you can see an autosomal dominant disorder that you are concerned about. And so this is the typical pattern. Right? So if there's an affected child, there should be an affected parent. And these genes are involved in the autosomes, therefore there's no sex differences or two sexes affected. For example, Huntington's disease, Marfan syndrome, the Miller hypercholesterolemia examples. Other than these typical criteria, we have special features of this autosomal dominant disorder. So that is very important to understand, because once you see, your diagnosis in your mind with this clinical picture, but when you see that pattern of inheritance, there can be some conflicts. Therefore, once you know or once you identify these special features, you can come to a definitive diagnosis by clinically. Therefore, it is important to understand these clinical features in the special features in the autosomal dominant disorders. There can be new mutations. Therefore, there can be an isolated cases in the middle of the generation where the higher generation won't see that peculiar pattern of inheritance, but from there the lower generations can see the pattern of autosomal dominant disorders what I have explained with the criteria. And important other special feature is the reduced pericles. What do you mean by the reduced pericles? It is the all or non predominant in sequence, because you know that autosomal dominant disorders will transmits their genes from one generation to another generation. Therefore, it has to be manifest as a phenotype. But this sometimes these dominant genes will not manifest because the expression of number of people who have the gene is different because of this special feature that is very expected. Once the gene is there, it may produce the phenotype either mildly or severely, or else it's not present. So that is called the all or non phenotype or reduced phenotype. Other feature is to variable expressivity. That is the degree of expression from mild to severe. That you know that some autosomal dominant genes can transmit from one generation to the other generation, and this will be expressed in the very milder form or with the very severe life-threatening form, though that the mutation is the same in that particular individual. So that is called the variable expressivity. Another important feature is the variation in age of onset. As all you know, in adults, polycystic kidney disease, the condition will manifest later life, not in early childhood. Usually, in the early childhood, they are the normal and they develop polycystic kidney disease. So, therefore, there will be a variation in age of onset because the clinical features manifest later in their life. And other important fact is called the anticipation or variation in severity between policies. For example, in the Huntington's disease, where it manifests very early in their offsprings, if the father is affected, if the mother is affected, it might be much later. So that is called the anticipation that is important when interpreting some important clinical features, and basically it is very important when it comes to the genetic counseling. And all you know what is phenotype, but what is phenotropy? Phenotropy is the environmentally caused phenotype. It means that particular person or the program, the genotype, genetic composition is normal. However, they presented with similar clinical features of that phenotype of an autosomal dominant disorder, which caused by an environmental agent without genetic involvement. So that is called the phenotype. And another very important feature is the genetic heterogeneity, where you will see the same clinical picture or the same clinical features of an individual, but the involvement of the genes are different. So there may be different loci can responsible for that particular same clinical feature in that particular individual. So these are the important special features that we will see in the autosomal dominant disorders other than the base gain criteria I have explained. So therefore, you have to have in mind these special features once you come across with a suspected case with an autosomal disorder. So it can be complicated with these features once that comes to the diagnosis. Therefore, it is important to know that. Here, I will show a simple autosomal dominant pedigree chart where I have three generations. And so you can see the first generation, two individuals are there, and the second generation, there are six individuals, and the third generation, again, there are six individuals. So that first generation, the second individual is transmitting the disease with autosomal dominant, and it transmitted into the one male and the one female in the next generation. And from the third individual is transmitting again into the third individual and the fourth individual of the third generation. And the fifth individual is transmitting the disease into the fifth individual of the third generation. So there, try to understand this, right? Because once you come to the analysis, pedigree analysis, here, this is very important to understand whether that particular individual is homozygous or heterozygous in autosomal dominant pedigree. Because in the homozygous as well as the heterozygous state of the autosomal dominant, still gives off the desired phenotype. However, it is important to know whether it is homozygous or heterozygous to identify the recurrence risk and the transmission pattern. For example, in this case, the second individual of the first generation is homozygous. So they will produce two gametes with two dominant alleles. So therefore, all the children that comes with that are affected. Once the second, but the particular individual is heterozygous, so they will produce 50% of gametes are dominant, 50% are recessive. Therefore, the offspring will have 50% affected and 50% none. So this is very important when it comes to the clinical diagnosis and comes to the cause. Therefore, try to understand. And from this pedigree, try to make the genotype and the allele configuration of each and every individual as an assignment, right? Okay.
So the next the type of disorder is the autosomal recessive disorders. So the phenotype is usually observed by homozygous states. That means that you should need two recessive alleles for this phenotype. And normal parents, there can be affected offsprings. So that is what you can see in the when compared to the other. The autosomal dominant type of condition. So the criteria are all children of affected parents are affected. What do you mean by that? So all children of affected parents are affected. So the both parents are affected, that means they both contain recessive alleles. So the offsprings also will get only the recessive alleles. Therefore, all children are affected. And however, if the parents, they are heterozygous, then what will happen? So segregation frequency then comes in the two heterozygous as 25% affected and 50% carriers, 25% homozygous normal. So this is the important point. So you can make the Punnett chart and you can make this calculations, right? So this is important when it comes to the clinical scenarios as well as in the counseling. And this also is involved with autosome, therefore the both sexes are affected equally. And important fact is that consanguinity increases the incidence. The first cousin has 1/8 of grandparents' genes, therefore there's an higher risk of affecting these autosomal recessive disorders. For example, sickle cell anemia, thalassemia, cystic fibrosis, homocystinuria. Yeah, you can see a lot of these kind of conditions in consanguineous marriages. So when it comes to the autosomal recessive pedigree, you can see there are two individuals, the second generation, third individual, and the fourth generation, the second individual is there. So the parents of the third individual of the second generation, they are normal. However, the second generation, there is a the patient with the recessive condition. So this first and second, so they should take care here. And you can see this, they are the first cousins. They have married. They have mated. So this will increase again this recessive condition. So once you will get this kind of autosomal recessive pedigree, so therefore you should be able to identify who are the carriers and who are transmitting and who are normal. So therefore, again, try to understand the genotypes of these different individuals and try to draw it. So when it comes to the X-linked recessive disorders, so we have now completed the autosomal dominant and the autosomal recessive. So when it comes to X-linked recessive disorder, so that is the sex-linked disorder. So this is always males are affected. Why? The X, there's an only one X that is in the male. Therefore, once a recessive gene is inherited, so it associates with the X or linked with an X to the male, so that male will be affected. But there is no male carrier state. So what are the criteria? So affected males do not transmit the trait to children of either sex, but daughters are carriers. Because males
can only transmit one recessive allele, and if the, the female is normal, not a carrier, then the daughters should not affect, but they can be carriers. But in males, transmit their Y to the their sons or the male offspring. Therefore, it won't transmit X-linked recessive disorder into the males. Another criteria is carrier female transmit the disease to 50% of sons and carrier state to the 50% of daughters. What do you mean by that? A carrier female, you can have a dominant allele and the recessive allele, and that links with X. And in male, if it is the male is normal, that only contain a Y chromosome and the dominant X allele. And once they get mated, and females produce 50% dominant and 50% recessive allele, and this will comes and mate with the X where it is dominant. Therefore, it only produces 50% daughters with normal and 50% daughters who are carriers. But when talk about the Y chromosome that comes from the normal male, where it comes and mate with the 50% of normal X-linked dominant, where it mate the normal male, and the X-linked recessive 50% will involve with the involved with the Y chromosome, and this will be a and this will be a affected males.
So there are no, more affected males than females. Why I have explained earlier. And heterozygous females show wide spectrum of features due to the random X inactivation. You know that the X chromosome, females contain two X chromosomes, and that will inactivate during their embryogenesis. One part of the X chromosome will get inactivated, and this inactivation occurs in that particular recessive allele. So there may be a different. There may be a different presentation in these people. And examples are Duchenne muscular dystrophy, Fragile X syndrome, hemophilia A. So this shows the typical X-linked recessive pedigree where I didn't include the carrier states, right? So here you can see the first individual in the first generation is affected. So that means it contains two X chromosomes with recessive alleles, and here it is normal. So one X chromosome with a normal dominant allele. So you can see it transmits to the males, right? Because the male in the first generation do not have a recessive allele. So they are females, offspring can be carriers, right? So here you can see both male and female have recessive alleles. So therefore, they are all children will be recessive. But here you can see there will be no affected parents, but you can see a male is affected. What do you mean by that? So there can be a carrier state in this this individual in the second generation, where it shows a male individual with an affected. So other females usually either can be carriers or normal, and this can be again a normal male. So try to understand again the genotypes associated with this X-linked recessive pedigree. So the next one is the X-linked dominant disorder. So usually males may be normal or affected. What do you mean by that? I have explained about the the reduced penetrance. So usually the dominant disorders can have this dominant.
Dr. Lahir, you are going out of the time. Could you please? Yeah.
Sure, give me 1 minute, right? Okay, so this will affect in the linked dominant disorder, usually will affect in the normal or affected. And the criteria are affected males never transmit into sons, and affected females, heterozygotes, cause 50% of each for sons and daughters, and there's no more females than males. The same is there. I'm not going to discuss in detail that I don't, there's a time is now up. So try to understand this. And the next one is the X-linked inheritance, where only males are affected because that is associated with the X-linked X chromosome. So Y chromosome. And in the pedigree, you will see only the affected males where it transmitted from the father. They then come to the mitochondria genetic disorders, where the mitochondria all contain some DNA where it carries from mother. Therefore, only the mother is transmitting the mitochondrial genetic disorders into the next generation. So this shows that mitochondrial inheritance pattern, where that the maternal lineage, so that mother is transmitting to the next generation, to both males and females, but males are not transmitting into the next generation. So the last one is the multifactorial inheritance, where the genes and most of the environmental factors are involved in the this condition. So therefore, there can be a lot of multifactorial inheritance in our society, and this usually it is familial conditions, and this also has the same genes that associate with the relatives with the same recurrent risk. However, this will increase the consanguineous parents, and it is much more complicated in these patients. And you can see there's no actual way of transmitting pattern, but you can see there are a lot of other factors that involve in the inheritance. So this is it's called the genomic imprinting, where the methylation of an non-expressed allele will get imprinted, whether it is a maternally derived or paternally derived. It sometimes affect if expression. So that is again an important variation that can be seen in the pattern of inheritance. So this is the case scenario. You will discuss later at the